Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Shirley-Ann Somerville on reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and hence there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government and the wider public sector has already done much to understand the extent of reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete RAC issues in Scotland, and we recognise there is more to do. Everyone with the responsibility for building safety takes this matter very seriously, and I want to assure the public that the Scottish Government is working at pace with partner organisations across the public sector on this challenge, and has been for some time. Risks associated with the presence of RAC in buildings is not a new issue in the construction sector. In order to fully understand the scope of RAC, including in the school estate, we have been working with local authorities, NHS Scotland and other public sector organisations in Scotland as they have conducted reviews of RAC in their properties. This allows us to better understand the extent of the issue, ensure that risks are managed and, where required, to be reassured that remedial work and mitigations have been put in place where necessary. Institution of Structural Engineers first published guidance on RAC to raise awareness amongst the structural engineering community in March 2022. My officials were made aware of this publication through engagement in professional channels at that time and have throughout supported reasonable building safety. For example, in July 2022, Learning Directorate officials made contact with Scottish Heads of Property Services and Association of Directors of Education in Scotland to discuss RAC. In December 22, NHS Scotland Assure commissioned a survey team to establish the extent and condition of RAC across the NHS estate. And early in the summer this year, my officials had met with HSE to discuss school estate matters, including RAC, and met with several local authorities individually to discuss their specific issues. In July this year, my officials issued RAC survey to all local authorities via the shops network. Furthermore, the Ministerial Working Group on Building and Fire Safety discussed RAC, pressing for and tracking progress on this issue since December 22. The Cross-Sector Working Group on RAC now supports our work as my officials join up with their sector counterparts and key public sector partners and representatives of the private sector. This has been established as a more formal forum to share good practice and recent discuss professional advice buildings and the work that's ongoing, which is already underway. More recently, my officials have been invited to join the Cross-UK Government Working Group on RAC. In various recent meetings, we have once again been assured that the current Institution of Structural Engineers guidance and the risk-based approach remains appropriate for the assessment and management of RAC in schools and other buildings. The most recent discussion with the Institution of Structural Engineers was on the 5th of September, when my officials met with the director, who confirmed their RAC guidance has not changed and remains a good valid practice measure in this area, and we have issued it to local authorities for their information. The Institution of Structural Engineers remains of the view that their guidance is in keeping with the Health and Safety Executive's approach to managing risk in a proportionate manner and considers all relevant factors. While the issue of RAC has been in discussion for some time and action has been taken, the UK Government Department of Education changed their approach for RAC, specifically in schools, on 31st August, a change in approach which Scottish ministers learned through the media. Presiding Officer, events of recent weeks have highlighted a deeply concerning level of chaos in the UK Government overseen by the Secretary of State for Education. It is totally unacceptable that UK ministers prioritise briefing the media before alerting or sharing crucial information with devolved governments, in what can only be described as a complete dereliction of duty. It wasn't until 1856, on Sunday, 3rd September, that the UK government shared four pages of RAC photographs dating as far back as 2018. Photographs, not detailed or comprehensive structural reports, just photographs with the bare minimum of supporting context. To be frank, the engagement has been insulting. Now, I can confirm to the Chamber that following receipt of the photographs, we are still waiting detailed and comprehensive structural reports, which we requested on Sunday 3rd September and again on Tuesday 5th September. The withholding of this information was completely reckless and irresponsible. The Secretary of State's disregard of the work of devolved governments could not be clearer. But more importantly, it has spread unnecessary alarm amongst parents, staff and children. Now, as I stated earlier, work has already been underway to deal with RAC in the school estate. To date, RAC has been identified in 40 school buildings across Scotland, albeit in some of those it is in parts of the building which have not been in use for some time. Wherever RAC has been found, mitigations have been put in place. For example, St Kertigan's Academy in West Lothian has closed parts of its estate, including dining and kitchen areas, and Preston Lodge School in East Lothian has taken action to close off impacted classrooms and other areas. Riverside Primary School fully closed its building over the summer holidays and moved pupils into alternative provision. COSLA have confirmed that safety is the central consideration and there is robust guidance which is followed by every local authority to ensure these buildings are safe for the pupils, staff and the public to be in. Now, local authorities have a clear responsibility to ensure their schools are safe for pupils, staff and their users. And I know they take this responsibility very seriously. They are carrying out assessments of their school buildings, and we are aware that some parts of the school estate and some councils still need to complete full surveys. Ministers have been clear to authorities that these must be carried out as a matter of the highest priority and have offered assistance to councils in this matter where appropriate. However, it is imperative that there is transparency around the schools where RAC has been identified and the mitigations in place, and we're working with COSLA to ensure that all local authorities will have published the information about the schools affected by the end of this week. The cross-government working group we established is enabling centralised understanding of how RAC is affecting other sectors of the public estate. Work is ongoing to assess properties across the public sector. It is important to state again that the assessment process is proportionate and based on the Institution of Structural Engineers' guidance. And I want to once again reassure the Chamber that where RAC has been identified, mitigations are in place in accordance with that guidance. What is clear, Presiding Officer, is that significant work will need to be undertaken across the public sector estate in Scotland and indeed right across the UK in dealing with RAC over the longer term. Now, the First Minister has been clear that while we don't have contingencies within government to spend on RAC, we will of course spend what we need to spend in order to ensure that our buildings are safe for those that use them. Now, I was pleased to see the Chancellor seeming to commit over the weekend that the UK Government will spend what is needed on this. But the more recent briefings coming out of the UK Government that there will be no new money are deeply worrying. Let me be clear that after a decade of Tory austerity and cuts to capital budgets, it is simply not sustainable for the UK Government to say that no new money will be made available. Now, this is an issue we have been alive to for some time. Long before the change in the approach by the DfE, on the 16th of August, the Deputy First Minister wrote to the Treasury seeking clarity on new capital funding to deal with RAC. Then on 3rd September, our Education Secretary wrote to the Secretary of State for Education seeking clarity on funding. Thus far, neither have received a response. Again, the ignorance is simply astounding in such a serious situation. The UK Government cannot put their head in the sand. New capital money has to be made available, including to the devolved governments, to allow us to take any action that may be required. Anything else would be a dereliction of duty from the Prime Minister and the Chancellor, and I would hope that I can count on the support of all members in this chamber in making this case to the UK Government. I'll close as I started, Presiding Officer. The safety of occupants in buildings and the buildings themselves is of utmost importance. The actions this government is taking, along with public sector and industry partners, is designed to ensure that appropriate measures are in place, provided for the short term and also the long term to ensure the safety of our buildings for their occupants.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for that, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who would wish to seek to ask a question could press the request to speak buttons now. And I call Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. It's clear that for over 40 years, the use of RAC will have been widespread in construction projects, not only in the school estate, but potentially across all buildings constructed during that era. We do need to see full transparency, and I welcome the publication of the information which the First Minister signalled at First Minister's questions. It is clear that the impact will stretch well beyond the school estate and include the NHS estate, GP surgeries, colleges, and potentially council housing built during that period. What is not clear from the statement today, though, is the position which the Scottish Government is taking and what policy and guidance will be issued to both councils, health boards, and also the further education sector when buildings are assessed as red, critical risk or high risk. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, she touched upon the Institution of Structural Engineers guidance, that if all public buildings which are assessed in category red, will the expectation be that these buildings will be closed to members of public?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Miles Briggs for that question? Can I say to him that I thought I had been very clear that our approach remains the absolute reliance on expert advice, and that is from the Institute of Structural Engineers. And that is very important. Now, for the sake of timings, I won't go through how they suggest we approach things, either in the red, amber or green, but that is publicly available. But I'm happy to provide that to the member, should he wish to do so. That's what is being followed at the moment. That's what we are strongly encouraging councils and other public bodies to follow in the future as well.
I call Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. This morning, the First Minister said that the Government have known about this issue for years. So why, I asked, did they not ask councils to investigate until the 17th of July? The Minister has complained about the lack of communication and transparency from the UK Government, and she is right to do so. But the Scottish Government itself has failed on communication too. So does the Cabinet Secretary accept that this failure has put Scottish local authorities on the back foot and has put pupils and staff in schools at risk? And will she confirm that the Scottish Government will do all they can to equip local authorities with the resources, including the skills and expertise, they need to fix this issue urgently?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not quite sure that Pam Duncan-Glancy was listening particularly to the first couple of pages in the statement, where we did go through the work that's been ongoing both with the national government and local government. And can I say to her, I don't have time to go into the details of the Welsh Education Minister's recent statement, but he will find exactly the same points being made that we are making, because he shares the same frustration and they are going through exactly the same process as we are. And we're staying very close, as I hope you would expect, Presiding Officer, to the Welsh Government on their approach. We will, of course, ensure that we continue to work very closely with councils. We have kept nothing from councils at all. Indeed, we have made requests from the UK Government that everything we get, we are able to share with local government. And we had to make that request specifically to them, and that delayed us being able to give even the small piece of information we have to councils. And that was a disappointment. But I hope the fact that we have tried to do that is an example of the principle that we are using with local government to ensure that we are working hand in hand with them on this issue.
I call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Craig Coy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the update on measures the Scottish Government has taken since first getting the guidance from the Institution of Structural Engineers. I find the Cabinet Secretary's comments extremely worrying, and also to also see what the Welsh Education Minister has said about timing, when we were made aware, etc. Can the Cabinet Secretary please reaffirm when the Scottish Government was first informed by the UK Government and how we can take this matter forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it is disappointing that we did learn about this only on the 31st of October and initially just through the media. And I think it's important that we have that very frank conversation about that's how we found out about things, because we need to make sure that that approach stops We have, again, as I said in my statement, asked the UK Government for further technical information, which we still don't have. So is the Welsh Government. And again, if we are, as I'm sure we all are, genuinely concerned and wishing to reassure members of the public, we surely, of all of issues, want to be working together on this with no surprises and full transparency within the governments. And I think that's why it's very important that despite the disappointing change and the way that that change was articulated to the Scottish Government, that we do see a new approach so that the administrations can genuinely be able to work together, share experience, share good practice and work out a way forward, although we will continue, of course, to follow the Institution of Structural Engineers' advice, which is different, of course, to the plans taken forward by the Department for Education.
I call Craig Hoy to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In March 2022, ministers were made aware of RAC guidance from the Institution of Structural Engineers, as the Minister has said. In July 2022, learning directorate heads first flagged the risks from RAC, and in May 2023, East Lothian Council took action to close parts of a local school. Yet it took until the 14th of August for the Scottish Government to convene a cross-public sector working group on RAC. If the safety of occupants of buildings, including children, is of utmost importance to this government, why the 18-month delay on taking action here in Scotland?
There wasn't any 18-month
Cabinet
delay.
Well, can I say again, there has been no delay on this. Again, I said in my statement about some of the examples of the work that's been ongoing on this, both at an official level and a ministerial level. We are very, very keen to ensure, as a government, that although we are not responsible for the local authority estate, for example, that we work very closely with our colleagues in local government to be able to share advice and good practice where appropriate. So that is why we continue to ensure we've got the right structures in place to make sure that we are receiving the reassurance that we have. But to say that no work has been undertaken either by local government or national government is not the case. And I think it does a disservice to the people in many local councils who have been working exceptionally hard on this issue for some time and reassuring parents, staff and pupils in the process.
I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Representative Officer. I've got one school in my constituency which is affected by RAC and it long predates devolution. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to highlight this point in her discussions with the UK Government, and it should fall upon the UK Government to actually fund any repairs that are required?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said in my statement, there are a number of letters that remain outstanding and awaiting our reply, both sent by various now members of the Cabinet to the UK Government on this issue. And I think it is very important that those letters are replied to at speed. And again, I would say this is a concern that is also shared not just with us, but also by the Welsh Government as well.
I call Jackie Bailey to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that it is in fact 254 buildings across NHS Scotland that are being surveyed? When was the survey, which was commissioned by NHS Scotland Assure in December 2022, escalated beyond a desk review? When will we know the results of the survey and will this be published? And can she confirm that there will be money urgently made available to remove RAC and make all NHS buildings safe for patients and safe for staff?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I mentioned the funding points in some previous answers and also on my statements, but in reference to the number that Jackie Bailey referenced, the desktop review identified 254 buildings that have two or more characteristics consistent with the presence of RAC. That does, of course, not mean that they have RAC, and that's why it's important that further work is ongoing on that. The surveys have now begun. In fact, the next phase of the surveys have commenced with more work that's going on site, not just a desktop review. This is clearly something that will take some more time. This will be around 6 to 8 months to complete the full survey programme within the NHS, but we are, of course, looking at opportunities to expedite that process, if at all possible.
I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Alex Gough-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that North Lanarkshire Council yesterday revealed that the Pivot Centre in Moodysburn, which is in my constituency, is one of two buildings in the authority identified to have RAC. North Lanarkshire Council have been in touch with me, and I'm grateful for the quick action that they've taken and the plans to carry out work, the future plans to carry out work at the site. The Council have also noted that up to 400 houses in the local authority area may be affected by RAC. Can I therefore ask what support is the Scottish Government giving to NLC and to other councils to identify such properties?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think it's very important that the local authorities are able to talk not just about what's happening within the school estate, but in their wider public sector estate as well. As I said in my statement, we are keen to ensure, working alongside COSLA, that all councils have published the information about their school estate by the end of this week. There is clearly more work to be done then to ensure that there is transparency around what's happening within the wider council estate too. That includes, of course, housing. We are still in the discovery stage of finding about that awareness within the housing sector, but that's exactly why representatives from the Scottish Housing Register and the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations and indeed the Chartered Institute of Housing have all been invited to participate in the cross-sector working group to ensure that this sector, both for the public and private sector housing, is involved in the work ongoing.
I call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Keith Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, if ministers were really across this problem, don't you think that Parliament and the public would have been told sooner that at least 40 schools and an untold number of hospitals contain this potentially lethal concrete? Ministers were nowhere near even understanding this. No money was put aside. Instead, Liberal Democrats, not the government, were the first to lay bare the scale of this problem. Indeed, the trigger for schools closing in England was a concrete beam failing at a school in Dunblane, a beam that was rated as safe, but it failed. And the Scottish Education Secretary said on Channel 4 News last night, and I quote, that this was an isolated incident. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with her colleague? And if so, how can she be sure this won't happen again, especially when we still don't know where this stuff is or how it's been used?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say to Alex Cole-Hamilton, again with the greatest respect, one of the reasons why this has not raised to the same public alarm as has been caused since the Department for Education's change in approach last week is because national government and local government have been quietly getting on with the job of ensuring that the work is being done. And that's exactly why some of the examples I gave in my statement in East Lothian and West Lothian, that already predated the rigmarole that we've had over the past week or so. So parents have been getting informed, so have the staff and so have the children. And that's quite rightly done by those responsible for the building, responsible through the local authority, who have been working with the local community about exactly what to do in it. And to say that nothing's been done, I'm afraid, is again disingenuous. And I would point to some of the projects that have already been undertaken through LEAP phases 1 and 2 that have dealt with some of these issues already. And in the example of Dunblane, I think the Dunblane School, which is an MOD school, this was not reported to the Scottish Government. It was not reported to any education authority in Scotland after that incident happened, either by the school or the Ministry of Defence or the Department for Education. The first time we found out about it as Scottish Government ministers was on the 31st of August. So this is a very clear example, once again, of a disappointing lack of sharing of information for that exact school.
I call Keith Brown to be followed by Ariane Burgess.
I should say, President Officer, my question was about the constituency interest which I have, which is the school that's just been mentioned by Alec Cole-Hamilton, who doesn't represent Dunblane. But can I ask, in relation to that school, RAC issues were identified at Queen Victoria School in Dunblane, as well as at Stirling University, which I'll take up separately with the relevant minister. Both are very important institutions in my constituency. My understanding is, of course, that QVS is an MOD school. The responsibility for its upkeep lies with the UK Department of Education. And can the Cabinet Secretary, in addition to what she just said, confirm that any issues that have been identified have been dealt with and that there's no ongoing risk to students and staff in either of those buildings? And as QVS is an MOD school, if the Scottish Government was made aware of the RAC issues at QVS when they were first identified by the Department of Education?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we understand that there was an issue at that MOD-run school in March 2023. It was investigated by the MOD in April that year and reported to the Department of Education for the UK in May 2023. As I said in my previous answer, the Scottish Government was informally told of this incident during a phone call that the Cabinet Secretary for Education had with Baroness Barron last Thursday. We have expressed our concerns about the way that this whole school incident was approached. In relation to Stirling University, I understand that mitigation measures have been taken within the Students' Union where this issue has been identified.
I call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Liam Kerr.
As we're hearing, many of the buildings affected by RAAC are owned by local authorities, from schools like Charleston Academy and Forres Academy to libraries and community centres. The Verity House Agreement sets out a new partnership approach with local authorities with added emphasis on working together on areas of shared responsibility. What more can the Scottish Government do to work in tandem with local authorities to give reassurance to members of the public that all arms of government are working together?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this is a very important point about us working together on this issue, and that's why the Cabinet Secretary for Education and myself met with COSLA officials and some of the councillors as well at the start of this week, and we will again do so next week too. It is important that we not only publish information about the schools, but the local authorities ensure that they provide context to that. Yeah. So we have, for example, schools where RAAC has been identified, but it's been on a part of a building that's not been in use for many years. So yeah. The context is important to ensure we're reassuring the pupils and staff and parents. And we will continue to work together. And as I said in my statement, those meetings will continue, not just about the school estate, but also on the wider council estate too.
I call Liam Kerr to be followed by Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the North East, several schools, including Mackey, West Hill and Northfield Academies, and Abbotswell, Cornhill and Quarry Hill Primaries, have now been confirmed to contain RAAC. Now, Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray said last weekend there is no immediate risk to people using those buildings. Yet the First Minister said on Monday a review whilst councils check buildings will take some months. So on what basis did Neil Gray assert there to be no immediate risk, and what extra funding and assistance are being provided to Aberdeen and Shire councils to perform the checks?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the reassurance that people can be given, and I mean this with the greatest respect to my colleague Neil Gray or others, is because structural engineers, experts, have been working with the local authority responsible for that school to be able to ensure if RAAC is there, to what extent and what mitigation measures need to be put in place. And the government has had reassurances that those mitigation measures, where required because of that expert advice, are in place. Clearly, we will continue our discussions with all councils to ensure that we are keeping up to date on the mitigation measures and any long-term work that is required. And I hope Liam Kerr will join me in the calls that we're making to the UK government to assist all devolved administrations with the capital expenditure that will be required in the longer term once mitigations are requiring to be moved on to refurbishment or changes to those buildings, that we will get that extra funding from the UK Government as requested.
I call Bill Kidd to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much. There's been much discussion in the Chamber this afternoon about who should be doing what and when. And yet the reality is that without the borrowing powers, the Scottish Government cannot act by itself to fund wide-scale repairs should that be found necessary. In response to my question on Tuesday, the Cabinet Secretary stated that the Finance Secretary was still to receive a response from the Treasury regarding further financial support to help deal with the consequences of RAAC. Has a reply been received? I don't think so, but it would be nice to hear for sure again. And do we know how much we will be due? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as to how much any final bill will be, that will obviously not be able to be determined until all the structural surveys have been undertaken right across the estate. But with reference to Bill Kidd's earlier questions, no, I can confirm once again we have not received reply to the Deputy First Minister's letter of the 16th of August. And it is very important that we do receive that reply, because if the Chancellor is willing to go on television and talk about spending what it takes, then it is important that he then works with the devolved administrations to ensure that we have a plan in place to be able to take that forward.
Yep. And I call Fozil Chaudhry.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. West Lothian Council have been working for several years to identify and address the problem of RAAC in schools in the area. They have now been waiting 9 months for an announcement on the Learning Investment State Programme funding to see if the bid for a new school in Livingstone was successful. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise when an announcement will be made on this funding so that Council can actually begin to address the problem with RAAC in school?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Fozil Chaudhry for that question? It's a very important one because I appreciate that there are councils across the country that are waiting for announcements on LEAP Phase 3. As I said in an earlier answer, the LEAP Phase 1 and 2 has already dealt with some of the projects, indeed the projects that councils came to us with for 1 and 2 that involved RAAP were funded. Of course, Scottish ministers are now looking at the projects from local authorities where RAAC has been identified, and that will be part of the decision-making process for Phase 3. We are having to look very carefully at LEAP Phase 3, as I hope the member will understand, because of the increase in construction costs globally. That presents a major capital challenge for us, not just in the school estate, but I hope he can be reassured, and indeed West Lothian Council can be, that these matters are being taken into consideration when we do look at LEAP Phase 3.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the statement, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position should they wish. Thank you.